Welcome. We'll start with the fourth chapter for NCERT class 9, where we'll talk about the forest society. And we'll see, in the previous lectures we talked about how Russian Revolution, French Revolution brought out changes in the society, but these changes were brought with the local developments that took place. So locally, if we look around, be it parts of India, be it parts of South America or any other nation, forest made an important section for that country. So let's have a world map here to understand it better. So you have South America, North America, then you have parts of Africa, Asia. Now, what was happening during this time? We'll have a kind of brief outlook and then we'll move on to the chapter. Now, England at that time was looking for oak supplies. Slowly and gradually, the oak supplies from England vanished off. So there was no more oak supply that was present in Britain. So what Britain was now looking for was areas, potential areas where it could get the wood from. So it looked on to India, and India became a major exporter of timber. So India started supplying timber to Britain during that time. And this timber was mainly required for the industrialization that was taking place, for the railways that were developing, for the strengthening of the transport network, and so on and so forth. Now, if we want timber for a specific purpose, this timber would definitely come from forest, and for that you would have to clear the forest. So what was the sole idea here was the areas which were very potentially rich or which had huge dense forest covers were slowly and gradually being cleared off, and the process of deforestation started. Now, this deforestation came along with the loss of wildlife or the fauna. So as we said, the flora was losing because you had the plants, the vegetation that was cut off. Similarly, because there were lack of forests now, the wild species were slowly and slowly diminishing off. Again, hunting became a major fun event for most of the Britishers. Also, the Mughal period, the colonial period, saw a lot of hunting, and hunting and deforestation too became one of the major ideas during that time that led to the change in the existing system. Now again, this existing system, which was the region of rich forest, had lots and lots of local dwellers who were known as tribals. The population of these tribals slowly and gradually started to decline, or these tribals started to move on to subsidiary jobs or other jobs in the vicinity areas or the urban areas. So they were shifting from the lifestyle they used to live in to other lifestyle, or they were trying to modify themselves. This was also due to the advent of Britishers. There were numerous rebels that took place from the tribals. We already talked about the Birsa Munda, who was one of the major leaders from a tribal community who spoke against or rose his voice against the Britishers. So those were the kind of events that were developing. Again, the regions were divided into different villages. So let's say these are village 1, 2, 3. Now, if a person is producing within this village, that's well and fine, he can consume from that village. But if a person is requiring something from the next village or a nearby village, he would have to pay some kind of tax or money to the person in the other village, and then he could avail the facilities from that village. So those kind of systems also started to come up within the communities or between the communities. When Britishers came up, they made the areas, or they protected the areas into several regions. So there were three kind of forests that were demarcated. One was the reserved forest, the protected forest, and the village forest. Village forest were the region where villagers were given the rights to do the activity. Reserved forest were the areas where the villagers were not allowed to go into that area even. And protected areas were the areas which were protected for the purpose of utilization of the material from that village, from that forest, in the form of wood, timber, and so on. So As we said, the forests are a rich source for an economy. We get lots and lots of products, books, tables, chairs, all these can be availed from the forest. But what happened during the period of 1700 to 1995, nearly 13.9 million square kilometer of the forest or 9.3% was cleared for industrial use. Again, this deforestation led to clearing of the existing forest land. Now, this forest land that was cleared in 1600, it accounted for nearly 1/6 of the total land area of India. And during the recent years, in a period of around 200 to 300 years, this ratio increased from 1/6 to half. So half of the land area which was under forest was cleared for cultivation. Now, why people were more interested, or Britishers were more interested in cultivation? There were few reasons for it. First was to avail better facilities, like if they wanted to get wood for railways, or promotion of infrastructure for transportation and so on. So all those required wood, and therefore clearing of the forest became one of the primary cause. The second important cause here for the deforestation was to increase the source of income, and thirdly to increase the yield. So all those were the ideas that led to clearing of the forest during that time. And Britishers basically encouraged plantation cultivation. So when you talk about plantation cultivation, they required huge areas for cultivation, and those huge areas, when they require, they used to clear ample of forests that are present in that region. So let it be jute cultivation, rubber plantation, sugar plantation, all these plantations required huge empty stretch of lands, and these empty stretch of lands were cleared. And when they were cleared, the idea was a kind of extensive deforestation that would occur into that region. And once you have the deforestation that is occurring, it would have automatically its impact on the economy. A similar example was the case in Central American region, where you had the banana republics, or the Central American region, which are known as banana republics. Now here what happened was, there was an American company, United Fruits company, which grew banana for industrial use. And when you are growing banana for industrial use, you require lots of banana plantation in that region. As a result, this region came to be known as banana republics. Similarly, we already talked about how the oak was disappearing from the regions of Britain, and they required wood from other areas, so they were exploring new lands across the world. So Britishers came to India and explored the timber resources in India. Now when we talk about the expansion of railway itself requires lots and lots of timber. So when we talk about timber, in Madras presidency itself, only in the presidency of Madras in India, you had nearly 35,000 trees that were cut yearly. So it accounts for a huge number of forest area that was being cleared. And to prepare one railway sleeper, on an average, so for a kind of 3 meter wide broad gauge track, you require nearly one average size tree, and that one tree would yield only 3 to 5 sleepers. And for one whole railway, you require around 2000 sleepers. So there would be around 400 trees that would be cut for one train or one railway, that one rail line or one train that is being developed. So there was ample of cutting of forest, not only in India but other parts of Southeast Asia as well. Now, as we said, these plantations that were coming up were developing more. The idea was they required labor. Now the tribals who were being vacated from the areas of the forest were sent to the plantation farms for work, and in the plantation farms they used to work as laborers. When they were working as laborers, they were hired on a minimal wage. So the wages that they were getting were very less. Similarly, lots and lots of reforms were introduced for the forest region during that time. It was Detrich Brandis who was the first Inspector General of Forest in India. And when he came to India, he laid down a few interesting points. He talked about management of the forest, conservation of the forest land, Use of forest areas for a specific purpose. So jotting down the areas in which you could use the forest resources. He talked about that felling of trees should be done only for a specific purpose and not for all purposes. So let's say, let's specify it only for the construction of railway sleepers. The next was, he laid the foundations of Indian Forest Service in 1864 and formulated the Indian Forest Act in 1865. This Indian Forest Act was later on amended in 1927 and 1878. Now, Imperial Forest Research Institute was established in Dehradun and this worked on the idea of scientific forestry. Under scientific forestry, they said that you should plant only one kind of tree. And when you are planting only one kind of tree in the forest, definitely it's easier for the lumbering activity or the deforestation activity to take place because you would have all the poplar trees if you are growing poplar. And secondly, the important idea was when you are planting a single tree, you are replacing the old plantation. So first of all, you would have to cut the existing trees that occur and then you would have to plant up the new trees that exist in the region. So those were the things, kinds of development. Now, the villagers or the tribals, adivasis, on the other hand, were using the forest resources for numerous purposes. Some of the examples are the hardwood trees included teak and sal, which were used for sleepers, infrastructure, tables, chairs, and furniture building. Then you had fruit and tubers that were used for nutritional values, herbs which were used for medicinal values. Then you had wood that was used mainly in the agricultural implements. You had bamboo which was used for fencing, baskets and umbrella. Then you have sadhya, that was a creeper that is used to make the strong ropes. Again you had the bark of semur that is used to grate or tie the vegetables, the loop of vegetables together. So those were the kind of usage from the forest products that were obtained during that time. Now as we said, the forest rules were coming up, but during that time you had shifting cultivation that was popular. Let's have a brief idea about what is shifting cultivation once again. We have already discussed it in the previous lecture. So when we talk about shifting cultivation, the idea is basically, let's say I have a kind of big stretch of land here, which include three parcels. First of all, what I would do is, I would grow the crops on this region. Once the crops are matured, I would cut the crops, use the crops and burn this area. Now since this area is burnt, it has to be now left fallow. There can be no more plantation that could be done here. I would sow the seeds on the other land and then to the next and finally come back to this patch of land. Might be in a period of 5 to 10 years or sometimes in a period of 12 to 18 years as well. So you leave this land fallow for so long. Now this practice was very very common in Northeast India, in parts of Southeast Asia, and was named in different names in different regions. So for example, in Southeast Asia it is known as ladding. In Central America it is known as milpa. In Africa it is known as chitmi, and you have the complete list here. So this is something you must know or remember for your objective papers, and this would be available in the handouts. Now how the seeds are scattered here. So what you do is you just sprinkle out the seeds, and with the natural rainwater or the irrigation water that comes up, you have that seeds that pour or get inside the soil, and finally you have the vegetation that comes in. Sometimes mixed vegetation is also promoted in this, and the only issue that Britishers were facing because of this shifting cultivation in India was very interesting. Can you really guess it? The idea was Britishers were finding it very difficult how to tax people. Now let's say I have only one patch of land. It's very simple for the Britisher who is invading a country to tax me. Every year, every 6 months, he will come and say, pay the tax. Every 6 months, he will come and say, pay the tax. Now, if I have a shifting cultivation, he will come this year and ask me to pay the tax. In the next 6 months when he'll come, I'll be gone somewhere and it would be very hard to find me again. I might claim that I had already paid the tax or someone else had paid the tax or no one has paid the tax. It's very hard to decipher that. So Britishers were finding this system of shifting cultivation very, very difficult to tax people. And that was one of the reasons that they were promoting a kind of plantation cultivation where it became much easier for them to tax on the land and collect land revenue. So those were the kind of developments that were seen. Now, different communities were involved in shifting cultivation and there were kind of different activities or different cultivation patterns that were seen. For example, Tongya cultivation is a cultivation where the men digs the hole and female puts the seed there and then you have the plantation that comes up. So there were different methods which were known locally and which were promoted. We already talked about how hunting worked around. So hunting became a customary right for Mughals, later on for Britishers, and it became a symbol of status. So Maharaja of Sarguja alone shot nearly more than 1000 tigers and 2000 leopards. Under British administration, British administrator George Uley killed nearly 400 tigers. But later on it was realized when lot of conservatives moved in that this needs to be protected and environmentalists were gaining momentum. So slowly they were going against the idea of hunting. The next important development was trade. Now since the forests were cleared, hunting was not allowed. So what next activity could be followed? The next activity that could be followed was the trading activity. Now what happened under trading? The person used to take some product from the forest and sell it to the Britisher or some other community, and that was the kind of trading pattern that occurred. Munduruku people of Brazilian Amazon were very famous traders. Similarly, in India, you had the Banjara tribe, which are also nomadic. So those are again one of the major trading communities. Now, these were some of the examples that we talked about. Besides that, you had the rubber extractions in Putumayo, where you had the Peruvian rubber company that was solely dependent on the local people, and those local people were known as Hitutos. Similarly, in Assam, you had men and women who were working in the forest communities. You had the Santhals and the Oraons of Jharkhand, Gonds of Chhattisgarh, who were recruited to the plantation fields from the local areas, and they were given very meager wages or very small wages and have to live in very worse conditions. As a result, you had rebellion among the people that originated. We already talked about Birsa Munda. Similar to Birsa Munda, you had Aluri Sitarama of Andhra Pradesh, you had Sidhu and Kanu of Santhal Pargana. So all these were the major leaders who rose their voice against the atrocities on the villagers, on the tribals, who believed that these villages or these forests were their own land, and now they are being pushed out from their own land. So Bastar is one of the good examples. So south of Chhattisgarh region, which borders Andhra Pradesh, Odisha and Maharashtra, from the Bastar region. Now in the Bastar region, you had Indravati that crosses it from east to west, and you had numerous communities like Muriam Gonds, Durvas, Batras and Halbas, who are living there, who have their own language, own cultures and own customs. They show respect to earth and the natural surroundings. This Bastar kingdom was merged with Kanker kingdom and became the Bastar district of Madhya Pradesh. Later, it was divided into three districts of Kanker, Bastar and Dantwada. And in 2001, all these three became part of Chhattisgarh. Now, as we said, if you are trading from one village to another, you had to pay some kind of fees or tax, and that was known as Devsari, Dhand or Maan, and that was the value of trade or the exchange that you were doing with the other village. Similarly, to protect the own village, each village was keeping a watchman or a person who would look after the village resources so that you have the other villages don't become heavy on that and they don't try to extract or have a gainful business from your village. So that was the sole idea during that time. But during this time, again, The local people had a lot of fear in mind. The basic fear was because of the Britishers. The fear was that they were asked to remain in the reserved areas, and nearly of all the forest, 2/3 of the forest was reserved. Since there was a huge proportion of forest that was reserved, what happened was people were not allowed to hunt in that area, not allowed to collect food from that area, and not allowed to basically cultivate in that area. So basically, they had no other option but to move out from the villages. Now, since they were moving out from the villages, they were moving to some other area, and the place they were moving to, they had to pay huge rents. So this was a kind of vicious cycle. Once they were lost, they had lost their own resources, they had to move to other places, and when they were moving to other places, they did not have any source of income, and in lieu they had to pay huge taxes. So this was a kind of cycle of poverty that originated, and the poor started to become much poorer. So this was a kind of cycle which promoted or which increased the disparity between the rich and the poor during that time. Again, during this period, there were famines that affected the region, which further de-accelerated or demolished the situation of the local people there. There were numerous initiatives that were taken to raise voice against the Britishers. How this was done? Among the tribal groups. So among the tribal groups, they used to circulate pieces of earth, chilies or arrows, and those were symbols which circulated within the community, showing that they were planning to rebel against the Britishers. So if you had heard about some stories from history, you might have heard that people were moving out roses from one place to another when the independence movement was taking place, and that rose was the symbol that we support the movement against Britishers. So similarly, in the tribal groups, it was in the form of chilies, arrows, or the local earth pieces that they were trying to circulate. Now, this was the situation in India. The same was the situation in other parts of Southeast Asia. Let's move on to the next example of Indonesia. Indonesia now is a dominant or a major rice producing nation. But that time, it was a major supplier of teak. Now, what happened during that time? Dutch settlers were there in Indonesia, and these Dutch settlers were looking for a lot of teak that could be supplied to their country. Now, they were supplying the teak from Indonesia to their own country, but this teak was used for shipbuilding, and later Dutch feared that Japan would invade Indonesia. And in a mutiny with Japan, they did not wanted during that time Japan to have the control over the resources of Indonesia. So they started destroying the sawmills, they started clearing the forest, and they tried to extract as much as they could from Indonesia with the only sole motive that Japan should not get anything. Now, as a result, what happened? Indonesia economy wiped off, and the situation worsened out in Indonesia. Especially between the period of World War I and World War II, the situation was worsened further. Now, what happened during this time? During this time, there was again an interesting system which was known as Blankdong Stins system. Now, under this system, what happened was Dutch system first imposed a rent on a land. Now, for some of the villages, this rent was exempted. Now, for whom this rent was exempted? It was exempted for the people who could work as laborers, who could work in their industries, and who could work in transporting the timber. So, all those who could work for Dutch people were exempted from paying the rent. Rest all the people who were not exempted were the people basically who were not willing to work for the Dutch people had to pay the rent. So that was the kind of system where rent exemption became very difficult, and the only way to exempt the rent was to work for them and to be on a very meager or a very small wage, which became hard for the people to sustain. Similarly, you have Sami's challenge. Now, Sami was one of the persons who, one of the villages basically, and this village asked for the ownership. Now, the idea during this time was the ownership was solely in the hand of nature. That was their belief. No one can own the forest. So, they believed that the wind, the water, the earth, everything belongs to God and no one else has a right over it. So we should revolt against it. So nearly 3000 families came along with Sami from the village Randung Tong, and they rose their voice again together against the Britishers, speaking that they should be liberated and none of the area from their village could be used for that for their own purpose. So they said that they would not pay any kind of tax. They revolted. Lot of tribals basically went to the Fort Joanna to raise their voice against the Dutch people, but they were later on suppressed and could not win. So those were the kind of developments that came place, that took place. Even in India, it was only the tribals or the villagers who could protect the native land. So you had the various forms of sacred groves. You worship various trees like banyan tree. You had tulsi. So those are the common names you hear now. But similarly, you had numerous sacred groves that were worshipped during that time. They were known as sarnas. They were Kandus, Khan and Rai. So what they were trying to do was, they were trying to protect their own customary rights, their own villages, raise their voice against the Britishers and make sure that the resources that are coming from forest are not exploited by other nations or other people. So those were the kind of developments that were taking place. Similar to what was happening with the forest, you had numerous pastoral activities that were also taking place, which we would discuss in the next class. So stay tuned. If you have any doubts, you can leave those as comment below the video. We'll be more than happy to resolve those. Have a very good day ahead.